request Dean Professor Aruna Manam to start the next session to introduce Jafar Ali sir.
Yes, good afternoon. I'm glad to chair the technical session too, where we have got three speakers.
Ma'am, excuse me. Jafar sir, can you, Dr. Jafar sir, can you start sharing screen?
Okay, sir.
Ma'am, okay, ma'am, you continue.
Who is the first speaker?
Yeah, it's Jafar Ali, sir, madam.
Okay. Right. So I'm glad to chair the technical session too, where we have got three speakers. And I deem it as a privilege to introduce Dr. H. Abdul Jafar Ali, sir, who is Assistant Professor and Head Department of Biotechnology from Islamia College, Paniyam, Mali. And coming to his current research areas, he's expertised in taxonomy and diversity of acidians, DNA barcoding of acidians, natural products of acidians, bioremediation of heavy metals in marine ecosystem, and he's also expertised in identification of acidians. And he has gained teaching and research experience of more than 17 years, and he has carried out research projects funded by DBT and UGC, which are like DNA acidians, barcoding of marine acidians, funded by DBT, and it was carried during 2013 to 2016 years. And also, research project which he has completed funded by UGC was restoration of biodiversity in Yelagiri Hills during 2019, and he has also done one project funded by TNSCST, which was on biopotential efficacy of marine acidians. It was during 2019, and he's also serving as consultant of DNA barcoding of marine animals and bioassay antimicrobial antioxidant and anti-mitotic assays, and he's conferred with many awards and honors. Few of the best awards are: he's recipient of Scientist of the Year 2019 for the outstanding contribution in the field of marine biotechnology, conferred during second International Conference on Global Initiatives for Sustainable Development Issues and Strategies held on 23rd to 27th June 2019 at Bangkok, Thailand, by Gochar Educational and Welfare Society, Uttar Pradesh. And he's also recipient of Best Oral Presentation Award, conferred for the paper entitled DNA Barcoding, a Tool for Identification of Acidians from Indian Coastal, which was presented during second International Conference on 23rd to 27 June 2019 at Thailand. And he's also outstanding scientist in marine science 2018, declared by Academy of Tiruchi, Tamil Nadu. And he's also got Hargobind Khurana Memorial Award for Zoology, which is prestigious award, during 2016 by Bose Scientific Society, Tamil Nadu, scientific research organization. And he has also visited countries like Thailand, where he has gone to attend and present research article in second International Conference on Global Initiatives for Sustainable Development Issues and Strategies. And he's also a life member of Bose Scientific Society, Tamil Nadu, scientific research organization, and also life member of Association of Indian Biologists. And he has been invited as a special guest, where he has attended to disseminate workshop on outcome of CEBPOL program held on 5th December 2018. It was on Indian Habitat Center, New Delhi, organized by National Biodiversity Authority. And he also attended as expert committee member for meeting on invasive alien species to finalize a draft national list of invasive Asian species. Alien species in India, which was held during 6th to 7th February 2018 at National Biodiversity Authority. And leaving out all this, he has guided PhD scholars who are awarded under his guidance. And two more students are pursuing PhD, and he also awarded 14 MPhil students. and he has got publications to his account where he has published more than 73 papers and in international and national conferences, including proceedings. And he has also published books, both at international and national level. And he has organized many workshop seminars. And he has also presented and attended all international and national conferences. And he also delivered invited talks at various international and national conferences. So with this, now I invite Jaafar Ali sir to present or to give you a presentation. Thank you. And welcome you to this platform, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Is my voice audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you for having given a very good morning to one and all. At the outset, I would like to thank the organizing committee, and I would like to thank my dear friend Dr. Abdul Kalim Khan for having invited me as a resource person to deliver invited lecture on the title DNA barcode. Then I am very happy to be associated myself with this national conference on the land and environment. Very happy. Okay, now let me start my presentation on DNA barcoding technology. So DNA barcoding is nothing but the molecular tool used for the identification of species. My whole presentation is summarized here. First, I would like to give you a brief introduction about the status of the biodiversity, then the importance of the taxonomy in assessing and conserving the biodiversity, then what are all the limitations which we face in the conventional taxonomy for identification of the various organisms, and now the introduction to DNA barcoding, then about something about the mitochondrial DNA, where so many marked genes are there. We are going to see about all these genes. Then the protocol of the DNA barcoding, how to perform the DNA barcoding to identify the species and also to create the DNA barcoding for various organisms. And the applications in which field, where and how we can apply the DNA barcoding technology. So these are all the things we are going to see in the 30 to 40 minutes. Okay. The diversity of life. It has been estimated approximately that the Earth is or may be provided with 10 to 100 million species of organisms. This is approximately estimated by the various scientists across the world. Out of this 10 to 100 million species, just 2 million species have been so far documented and identified properly and accurately. So imagine, out of 10 to 100 million species, just we have identified and documented the 2 million species only. What about the other species and where we are? So what's the problem actually in identifying the species? See, this is the approximate data of the species so far documented as per the IUCN 2010. So the number of species and the vertebrate, the invertebrate species, and also the plant species. It is estimated that this number may represent as little as half of the true number of species, of this 10 million species. See, there's a big challenge before us, particularly the taxonomists and those who are working on the biological organisms. So, Only 2% of the 2 million species have been identified out of the 10 to 100 million species. So there is a big question in front of all of us regarding the rest of the species. Okay, what's actually the problem? What actually the problem? So the governments of many countries, they have acknowledged that there is a taxonomy impediment for the sound management and the conservation of the biodiversity. Yes, many governments, through the Convention on the Biological Diversity, they have acknowledged the existence of the taxonomic impediments, that is, issues. So we know identification of large and charismatic species is somewhat easy. But in the case of small organisms like insects, and the lower plants, fungi and microorganisms, it is very difficult and tough job to identify these small and micro level organisms. So for the identification of these kinds of species, one requires the expert skills for the accurate and correct identification. So one has to develop the identifying skills. It is very, very difficult one to acquire the skill of identifying the micro or smaller organisms, particularly the invertebrates and the lower micro plants. So why the taxonomy is so important? We are talking about the biodiversity, conservation, management, then sustainable utilization of the biodiversity. So we are all talking about the biodiversity always, but only few are concerning about the taxonomy, because the taxonomy underpins all the biodiversity aspects. Without taxonomy, we cannot assess or manage the biodiversity. So first and foremost thing is taxonomy. Taxonomy, we all know that it is a branch of science dealing with identification and the nomenclaturing of the species. The global biodiversity, we all know that, is being lost at an unprecedented rate as a result of the anthropogenic activities. So the decision makers of a country have to know the protected areas, which area to be protected, which group of animals and plants to be protected. So the decision makers should know the protected areas so that they can make a decision, and so that they can protect the necessary biosphere or any other biodiversity rich hotspots. Similarly, the regulators. Nowadays, we are facing the important issue called the damages caused by the invasive species. Invasive species are nothing but the species which enter into the new geographical area across their own geographical boundary. So due to the invasion of the many species in terrestrial or maybe in your aquatic system, they cause the harmful impact over the native species. So the regulators should know, and they should identify the invasive and the native species so that the regulators can combat the harmful invasive species. And the developing countries, they ensure that they reap the benefits of the use of their biological diversity. Only if they do not know the biological diversity that is being used. So one has to know the importance of the biological diversity so that we can make use of the available biodiversity for the development and the wealth of our country. So all these focusing on the importance of the taxonomy. traditional taxonomy has taken nearly 250 years to provide the description of the less than the quarter of the world species, that is the 2 million species. For the description and identification of the 2 million species, we have taken 250 years. Imagine. So why this much gap? Why we are very lacking in identifying the huge number of species? So far, the traditional taxonomists and the professional taxonomists, they used the taxonomic keys or the morphological keys for the identification of the various organisms. You might have heard that my taxonomic keys. So what the taxonomic keys says? Many morphological keys sometimes written by those who do not need them. The morphological keys are written by the taxonomist only. So they don't need their own taxonomic keys. Okay. But the morphological keys are written by those who do not need them. And these morphological keys are written for those who cannot use them. The taxonomic keys are available for the non-taxonomist, but the non-taxonomist cannot use the morphological keys to identify accurately the species. So this is the major problem of adopting the taxonomical, traditional conventional taxonomy keys. So this is a major hurdle to identify the large number of species in a short span of time. So then what are all the limitations in the conventional taxonomy key? The first and foremost is the very few number of taxonomists available in the world. Dwindling number of taxonomists. For a particular group of organisms, there's no taxonomist nowadays in the world. So that the pathetic conditions we are facing. Very few taxonomists for the identification of plants or microbes, some other groups, and particularly the marine organisms, there is no professional taxonomist for the identification of the most of the marine group of marine animals. If the taxonomist is available, the second issue is only the few taxonomists can identify a collection of less than 1,000 species during their lifetime. Only a few taxonomists are available. They can identify at the maximum of 1,000 species during their lifetime. And third issue in the conventional taxonomy is the lack of collection approach. Now we have to go and nook and corner of the earth to collect the organisms. But we are very lacking behind in the collection of various organisms. We are repeatedly collecting the same geographical area. We are serving the same geographical area. We are collecting the same number of species or plants, animals like that. So we have to go for the untapped areas for the collection of the various organisms. And the fourth one is the uncertainty in the identification. Even the professional taxonomists are able to identify the species, there is uncertainty in identification of that species. In a species description, you can see the taxonomist may have written in the first stage itself synonymous of number of species. The professional taxonomy themselves, they are not sure of their identification in the particular cases. So there is an uncertainty in identification of the species. Then there are so many limitations in the other conventional taxonomy. So these are the five major hurdles which hampers the identification of or the excelling the species identification in an accurate way. Now we will see what are all the limitations in the conventional taxonomy. The C. So the morphological dissimilar marks. Similarly, morphological dissimilar marks. So these are some examples for the morphologically dissimilar, but genetically they are similar. This we call the morpho species. And how do we determine whether the similar looking morpho species from different locations are the same or different? So by the conventional taxonomical methods, we cannot identify this kind of morphologically similar or morphologically dissimilar and genetically similar morpho species. This is called the phenotypic plasticity. Second issue is linking the larval forms to the adult, respective adult. We all know that the larval forms of all vertebrate animals looks alike. One cannot easily differentiate and one cannot easily link the larva into the respective adult species. So with the larva, we cannot adopt the conventional taxonomy to identify the species, because the most of the characteristic features of the larva of many species are similar. Okay, so documenting the taxonomic diversity should not rely only on the adult specimen. Okay, so this is the another hurdle in the adopting the conventional taxonomy. The another thing is, so here the one species called the liver plume, it has so many hosts during their lifetime. The first host is the goat. Second host is the snail. Third host is the grass. So this species has three different hosts, and in each host, their morphological and anatomical features are entirely different. So the tracking the life cycle of species is very difficult in the case of the organisms which has the multiple hosts. So in species with the complex life cycles, especially the parasites like liver plume, with multiple hosts, the conventional taxonomy fails to identify. Similarly, in the case of linking male and female morphologies, in many diptyrian and hymenopterian insects, the species identification is based on the male genital parts only. The female morphology is more conserved and useful at the genetic alignment, but not species identity. So, documenting the taxonomic diversity should not rely on male specimens only or female specimens only. So these are all the hurdles or impediments while using the conventional taxonomy and the taxonomic keys. See, in the classical taxonomy, we are using these so many terminology. And all these terminologies can act as a barrier to understand, and also all these terminologies reduce the number of persons qualified to describe a diversity. Nowadays, that the students or research scholars or even the faculties are like this, they are not very much interested in handling the taxonomy paper or taxonomy field. They never come forward to take the taxonomy as a interesting subject or the important subject. We prepare the biology, zoology, plant, biochemistry, biotechnology, agronomy, like that. But no one is coming forward to take a taxonomy as an important subject, because so many terminologies one has to memorize. And it is very difficult to understand the terminologies used in the classical taxonomy. This reduces the number of persons qualified to describe the species. See, to describe a single species, one has to go through all the morphological and the anatomical taxonomical characters. It is very difficult to study all the taxonomy characters. It will take hours together. One has to spend a lot of time in the laboratory, in the microscope. Even then, it is very difficult to identify the species in 100% accuracy. Similarly, in the case of animals or the small invertebrates or microorganisms, one has to go through all the descriptions, all the morphological and anatomy structures, each and every taxonomical structures. One has to study, one has to draw, and one has to compare with the already existing description of the various species. So it is very difficult. It is time-consuming, a laborious one. But use of the molecular markers to identify the species with gene sequences is somewhat easy when compared to studying all the morphological descriptions, as in the case of the classical taxonomy. You will see how we are, it is very easy to identify species based on the molecular sequencing. So, how do we complete the task of identifying large number of species? Only 2 million species so far identified, and we have to identify the rest of the species. How we are going to complete the task? There are so many limitations which we have seen. These limitations in the convention taxonomy have signaled the need for a new approach for the taxon recognition. So what is a new approach? It's nothing but a molecular taxonomy. Taxonomy at molecular level, simply called DNA barcoding. So DNA barcoding is an emerging technology proposed by the Herbert and his co-author in 2003. They proposed the use of a short sequence molecular gene which is present in the mitochondrial DNA. And this gene is called the cytochrome C oxidase subunit 1 gene. And this CO1 gene is recognized as a standard diagnostic region in the mtDNA, that is mitochondrial DNA, which help identifying the species, define the species boundary in the case of the invasive cases, and aid in the species delimitations. Well, what is DNA barcoding? We all know this, the universal bar product code, UPC symbol. So it is present in all the commercial products in the supermarket. You can see the barcodes of the product. If you scan the barcode, you will come to know the complete knowledge or information about that particular product. So this is called a universal product code, consisting of the 11 variable proportions and with 10 possible numbers. Now it has come in the two-dimensional way, three-dimensional way, like that. So many advancements has come. Similarly, for the identification of the speech, uses ATGC. So with these four letters, one can identify large number of species. So this is called a DNA barcode. So what is DNA barcode? It is based on the use of short DNA sequence, which can be used to identify different species, as in the case of the UPC barcode. So he is a Paul Herbert, who is the father of the DNA barcoding technology. In 2003, Paul Herbert and his co-workers at the University of Guelph in Canada proposed the DNA barcoding as a way to identify the species. So this DNA barcoding provides a central catalog of organismal diversity, and this database or the catalog can be accessed by anyone, which can be accessed by anyone who needs to quickly and accurately identify their own species. It is commonly available open offline data base available in the NCBI or in the BOLD, World Wildlife Database Systems. So anyone can access the sequencings created and developed in the NCBI and the BO BOLD system to identify their own species. Even non-taxonomist or any common man can use this catalog. And this would also allow us to differentiate new, previously undescribed species from those already observed. So one can easily describe the new species based on the DNA barcoding sequences. Similarly, this database will help conservation of biodiversity, diagnosing the diseases in the various plants and animals, and monitoring of the invasive species. So for which the central catalog, that is the DNA barcode database, will help. Okay, then how to make that reference sequences of database? Here, first the professional taxonomist can do this. First, we have to generate or we have to create the DNA barcodes for the species available or the species of our interest. Say, for example, I am the professional taxonomist of the marine organism called Acidia. Okay, I'm a professional conventional taxonomist. I can identify the marine Acidian species based on the morphological features. So I could create the DNA barcodes for the marine Acidians. Nearly I have developed the DNA barcodes for the more than 60 species of marine Acidians based on the DNA sequences. And these sequences are available in the NCBI and the BOLD system. So anyone can access and anyone can download the species sequences and they can compare their own species sequences for the identification. So our database, the Acidian DNA database, is available. And this database is now being used by many research scholars. They are working in the field of marine Acidians. Okay, so the professional taxonomist can create the reference barcode sequences in the BOLD or NCBI, for which we can make use of the available museum specimens. The professional taxonomist can do this, and the significant funding is now available readily with the government for the DNA barcoding of various group of organisms. So this barcoding has sparked a renaissance of interest in taxonomy studies, I hope so. See, what sequences we need to for the DNA barcoding? What sequence we need? What sequences we have to concentrate and we have to do the sequencing work? See, for the bacteria, in the case of the bacteria, if you want to identify the bacteria based on the molecular taxonomy or DNA barcoding sequences, we have to use the molecular marker 16S RNA. So we have to isolate this 16S RNA, we have to amplify it, and we have to sequence this marker gene in the case of bacteria. In the case of fungi, the marker gene is called a transcribed spacer region. So this is the molecular marker for the identification of the fungi species. In the case of plants, there are number of sequences available. Marker genes are available. Among these, the two genes are most commonly used for the identification of the plant species based on the sequences. That is ribulose-1,5-phosphate carboxylate gene and mutarase A. These two genes are commonly used for the identification of the plants. In the case of animals, the cytochrome oxidase subunit 1, which is present in the mitochondrial genome, is recognized universally as a barcode gene for the identification of the most of the organ animals. See, this is the structure of the mitochondrial genome. So a typical animal cell, here the mitochondria is there, inside the mitochondria. Yeah. Hello?
Sir, how much time it will take, sir, for
another 20 minutes, sir.
20 minutes. Sir. Can you sum up in 5 minutes? Because next speaker is having some work, it seems, so he's given reminder.
Okay, Rashad. I try to finish by 10 minutes.
Sir. Thanks for listening.
Yeah, okay. So this is the structure of the CO1 gene, where you can see the cytochrome oxidase 1 gene. So here there are so many regions in the mtDNA, and each gene has its own applications. And this is the plant cell where you can see the chloroplast genome, nucleogenome, and mitochondrial genome. Among these three, chloroplast genomes are most commonly used for the DNA barcoding. And this is the plant genome, marker genomes. Out of these three, two are the RBCL and MUK. These two genes are commonly used for the identification of the species. So these are the various genes for the plant DNA barcoding. And how DNA barcode works? So the protocol, how to do. So see, this is a simple protocol. So first we have to sample the species of interest, whatever may be the organism, or plant, or microbes, or animals, whatever may be. We have to sample the species of our interest. Then we have to choose the particular part or the organ of the plant or animals. Then we have to extract the whole genomic DNA. From the whole genomic DNA, we have to amplify the specific gene of interest, particularly in the case of animals, CO1 gene. We have to amplify this CO1 gene with the help of the universal primer which are available. After PCR amplification, the PCR product has to be visualized based in the gross electrophoresis. Then after purification, the PCR product has to be sequenced in the Sanger's sequencing method. After cleanup, sequencing has to be edited and scanned. Then the good quality sequences have to be selected. Then it has to be submitted in the NCBI or in the BOLD system. So this is a protocol, sampling, then DNA extraction, then amplification, visualization of the DNA bands, then sequencing. There are so many projects available under the consortium for the Barcode of Life. You see Barcode of Life, International Barcode of Life, initiated by the Paul Herbert in the Canada. And this is the CO, and there are so many countries for being a member in the Barcode of Life, and these are the various DNA barcode projects across the world. Norwegian project, Polar Barcode Life, and the Pakistan Barcode of Life, Japanese Barcode of Life, Pakistan, African, and so many German like that. So, and for the plant DNA barcoding also, there are so many projects across the world. You can see the tree Barcode of Life, grass Barcode of Life, DNA barcoding of endangered plants, barcoding of plants in China, and the Canadian Center for DNA Barcoding, DNA Barcodes of Biomass, like that. So this is the graph which shows the number of applications increased after the development of the DNA barcodes. So there are so many applications published with describing the new species, reporting the new record of species based on the DNA barcoding. And these are the various projects available throughout the world, and most of the projects have already been completed. Fish barcode, mammalian barcode, and then Fermi CDA barcodes, the all birds barcodes, then Lepidoptera barcodes, sponges barcodes, then Trichoptera, marine barcode of life. And this is the database, world database, organized, maintained by the University of Guelph, Canada, the Barcode of Life database, that is BOLD. So where you can see the public data portal, barcode index number database, publications, and primary databases. And another database is National Center for Biotechnology Information, NCBI, where you can submit your sequences. And this Barcode will help as a live scanner. This will provide access to scientific records, allows non-scientists to browse and access species information to educate our health. So see, just an app is developed. So if you scan the DNA barcodes developed, this will show all the information about the protected species. Advantage I have already told. So DNA barcode is an alternative taxonomy identification tool. And it has the potential capacity for high throughput like the NGS. Once the reference database is established, one can apply this database. The non-specialist can also utilize this available database. The cost of DNA sequencing is nowadays dropping. So anyone can easily acquire for the development of the DNA barcodes and identification of species based on the sequences. And this research tool for assigning specimens to known species, the life history stages, at any stages we can use. We can use any stages, seed, seedlings, adult, any part of the plant or animals, even a single part, a small leg piece is enough to identify this species based on the sequencing. Damaged species, gut content, even droppings of the birds, all these sources can be used for the identification of the species, but which is not possible in the case of conventional taxonomy. And one reactions to the barcoding. There are so many scientists across the world, how they react to the barcode. Say, for example, in the case of the ecologists and other users, what they are saying is, this is what we need, how soon can we get started? Because the ecologists need to handle the large number of the database regarding the biodiversity. So they want this barcoding as an important tool and fast tool to identify the species. But in the case of traditional taxonomies, what they are telling is, species should be based on lot of characters, not just barcodes, because they never compromise their own expertise, because they have studied all the characters, morphological features, everything. So they need to establish all these characters for the identification. So even though they accept the DNA barcoding, but they are telling that species should be based on the lot of characters. From the forward-looking taxonomists like the recent researchers and the students, what they are feeling is, using this data as a species diagnostic is not new, but standardization and broad implementations are the great thing. From the barcoding practitioners like us, what they are saying is, I had my doubts at the beginning, but it really works as a tool for identification at 96% accuracy. So this is the reaction of the many taxonomists. So this is a bold systems where we have deposited our own sequences. We have deposited 3 tons sequences in the bold systems at 2017. So now it has, the number has been increased. And this is our data, the bold barcode system database available here. Our college, Islamic College, ranked the first in the deposition of the CO gene sequences in the bold system for the marine acidian species. So our college is the first in the world database in the contribution of the DNA sequences for the identification of the marine acidians. This is the database, and we have developed the DNA barcodes for our marine species. So some examples are given. Right, with this I conclude my talk. If you have any doubts, I'm very happy to clear my doubt to my knowledge. And this is my research lab and this is our research team. Any questions, please? I'm very happy to answer. Thank you.
What is the cost of DNA barcoding for one particular species identification?
Actually, you cannot use a single specimen for the identification using the DNA barcode. At least you have to sequence the 3 specimens for a single species identification. For the process depends upon the species and the specimens and the DNA yield. Sometimes in plants or in the small organisms, the DNA yield may be very less. So we have to repeat the isolation of the whole genome DNA, and we have to check the quantity also. So if it is in a sufficient quantity, then we can go for the amplification. In the amplification also, you have to provide the specific primer. If your unit is primer fails to amplify your gene of interest, again you have to repeat. So based on the accuracy, the costing will vary. First, you have to optimize your container, the piece or condition and the primer for your own species. Say, for example, in the case of microbes or bacteria, or in the case of plants, you have to optimize all the conditions, the DNA requirements, amplification conditions, and the primers. So based on this only, you can finalize the cost of the sequencing the species. Okay, so first one has to optimize. So once you optimize it is very cheap to identify your species based on the DNA barcoding. And there's so many private institutions are readily available to sequence your species, and they are costing differently. Say, for example, in the RGCP, Radhigan Institute of Patagonia, they are charging very less. Whereas in the case of the private sequencing center, they cost more. So it depends on the price of centers you select.
Thank you so much, sir. Over to Aruna, ma'am. Jayanta, sir, can you start sharing the screen?
I just thank Sir Abdul Jaffar Ali, sir. Thank you, sir, for being with us today on this platform and sharing your experiences. And thank you for making us understand about all aspects of diversity, taxonomy, conservation, sustainability, and applications of barcoding. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much. Thank you all.
Yes.